This is your brain. This is your brain when you had access to art and theater as a kid. A look at Julie's Green Room, ahead on Science Goes to the Movies. Welcome to Science Goes to the Movies, a look at the stories of science and how they change our culture. I'm Faith Saley. In this episode, we've got a wonderful combination of scientist and artist. Today, we've got Vanessa Lobue, Associate Professor of Psychology at Rutgers, plus Assistant Professor Natalie Brito of NYU is here. And they're joined by Emma Walton Hamilton, author and producer of the Netflix series Julie's Green Room. Welcome.
Thank you.
I'm thrilled to have all of you here.
It's lovely to be here.
Yep.
We're going to talk today about Julie's Green Room and the impact of arts education on early childhood development. For those of you who don't have a small child in your house, Julie's Green Room is a Netflix preschool program from the Jim Henson Company, starring Julie Andrews and featuring a cast of cloth characters learning about the performing arts.
We're going to be learning about the magic of the performing arts. Remember, every part, big or small, is important to our play.
Best friends make the best team.
We can do anything, dance, we can do it. We
can you guys ready for your big night?
Totally!
Put it all together, we can do anything.
Okay, Emma, I said it's a preschool show, but my son is now in kindergarten and I'm in my middle age, and I love it. It is so riveting in our household.
Yay, thank you.
We absolutely love it. Thank you for creating it.
Well, we like to think of it as a family audience show.
It really is. I mean, when I was a kid, we watched The Muppet Show, but this is
exactly.
Even more, I'd say, educational. How did the show come into being, Emma?
Well, I should probably start by saying that Julie Andrews is my mother.
And lucky.
Lucky me, right? And no, it's true, and she's every bit as good an egg as you might hope she would be. But she and I have worked together creatively in various different collaborative ways over the years for about 3 decades now. So we've done theater and film and written a lot of children's books together. And both of us are very passionate advocates for the arts. We both have an arts background, obviously. My background is in theater. I actually co-founded and ran a small regional theater similar to the one in the show for 17 years. So we drew a lot from that. And of course, her background is theater and film. And she's had a long relationship with the Henson family and the Henson Company. And Lisa Henson, one day they were in conversation, and Lisa said, I would so love to do a show with you for kids with new puppets and something about the arts and celebrating the arts. And my mom was like, where do I sign? And so that's how it started. And then it was a question of, well, what's the concept? And how do we celebrate the arts while engaging kids? And who are these new puppets going to be?
Was there a moment where you guys thought, Green Room? And
yes.
It just, like, what was that moment?
Absolutely.
Like?
Well, we pretty much right off the bat knew that it would need to be set in a theater. And probably since Julie is the star of the show, she would be the artistic director of the theater or the owner of the theater. And these puppets would be her students in the arts education programs that she offers. But when we were trying to think about what the name would be, we were throwing around all kinds of different names, and I can't remember which one of us, but one of us said, how about Julie's Green Room? Because the green room is so essential. And
will you tell people what a green room is?
Absolutely. So a green room is, it's basically the central space backstage where the company gathers before the show, during the show, after the show, in rehearsals. It's the common area where actors come to sign in for the performance, where they have snacks. They, as she says in the show, we meet, we eat, we rest, and we talk about how to make the show the best it can be. And there's one in every theater and one in every television studio and film studio. And it's a really beloved place amongst artists because it's where all the connectivity happens.
And Julie's Green Room does not have wine, I noticed.
It has a lot of punch.
Yes.
And grape juice.
As it should.
Yes.
Natalie, aside from the celebrity cameos, there are only 2 humans on the show. Right. Everyone else is a puppet. Why do kids love puppets so much?
I think for a variety of reasons. So if you look at The Muppet Show or Sesame Street, you know, puppets come in a lot of different shapes and sizes. They're colorful, so they attract a lot of attention and they're really engaging. Infants also love faces, and sometimes puppets have really exaggerated facial features that, you know, they like looking at. As well as, you know, kids love animals. And so on Julie's Green Room, there's a duck. And so children love identifying animals. They like kind of the interaction with these different animal personalities. And so for all these different reasons, I think kids love engaging and connecting with puppets in perhaps a different or maybe easier way than connecting with people.
Yeah, I wanted to ask both of you, psychologists, and you too, you can chime in. Emma, I find with my kids, they will have a very human conversation with anything inanimate if you anthropomorphize it, right? So yeah. My daughter started talking to my feet the other day. They had socks on them, and she decided they were her snake friends. But we had a full on, like, you know, her attention was focused for a good 15 minutes talking to my feet. And it's funny because she could have just done the play acting with me. Mm-hmm. But it's like when you have that one degree of separation, sometimes your kids will tell you things through the puppet or your feet or whatever that they wouldn't tell you one-on-one. Mm-hmm. Where do you think that comes from?
Well, one of the first things that kids have to learn when they learn about communication in the social world is what kinds of things can they communicate with? And one of the things they look for are eyes and a mouth and a nose. So faces are a good sign that something might talk to them. But another thing they use is sort of self-propelled motion. So if things move by themselves, you know, like this chair can't move by itself, but your feet move by themselves, yeah. And animals move by themselves. And sort of the third thing that they really use to tell them that something might be alive is sort of contingent interaction. So things that respond to them contingently. And even, you know, by 12 to 16 months, babies have learned to recognize sort of the back and forth of conversation. And they know that things that are alive are contingent. They know that things that are alive tend to have faces. And they know that things that are alive tend to move by themselves, whereas things that aren't alive can't do that.
Emma, on the show, there are five kids. They're puppet kids, but they're very well fleshed out little people. And they're from very different backgrounds, but they all come together for this Herculean task of putting on a show. And they're all consistently nice to each other. Now, is that because you and your mom are just extremely nice people and can't conceive of a show where anyone would be, you know, rude or graceless?
Well, what would you expect from Mary Poppins and her daughter? I mean, really. No, kidding aside, actually, I think that really has more to do with the fact that we were hoping to make the show as inclusive as possible, as embracing as possible for kids. We wanted, you know, for many kids who don't have regular or perhaps any exposure to the arts or to a performing arts center such as this, we wanted to show the truth of the matter, which is that it, you know, it is a uniquely inclusive place to be. The arts are for everyone. You may not be into performing, you may not be into singing, but maybe you're into writing, or maybe you're into scenic design, or working backstage, or you're just a great audience member, yeah. And appreciator, you know, and it's all valid. So we hoped that our audience would see themselves somewhere in the diverse lineup of kids and adults and go, oh, maybe that's for, if they can do that, maybe yeah. I can do that too.
See and a way to participate.
Exactly.
Be a part of it.
Yeah.
Vanessa, are kids born with an innate sense of graciousness? Does it have to be something they're taught, or are they good kids?
Well, yes and no. So there's research showing that by 14 or 18 months, toddlers are very helpful. So they can sort of read your intentions if you drop something on the floor and like, oh. They can pick up on that, and oftentimes they'll spontaneously help you out. But graciousness is something that sort of varies from culture to culture and family to family. You know, what is gracious and what are the rules of social interaction? So I think for the most part, it is something that they have to learn by example, by watching
modeling.
What the yeah. rules are around them. Yeah.
You know, a lot of, I'd say most modern shows show children who are very sassy. And it seems like the minute you step out of preschool stories, the characters can be downright rude. And in a way that some kids find entertaining, being kind of naughty in that way. Is that behavior exciting to kids? And if it is, I mean, is that kind of modeling good for a kid's development, do you think?
Well, I was going to say, I mean, I think what Vanessa was saying, you know, children learn from imitation, so modeling good behavior is always, you know, beneficial. Sometimes I think it may not be exciting, but maybe something out of the norm that they don't see, so it kind of grabs their attention in a way. And it could be beneficial for them to see, you know, kind of someone being mean on a show. Not because, you know, we want them to imitate that, but it could help them, you know, they're going to encounter mean people. And so knowing how that makes them feel about a situation, but you want to model how to get out of that situation.
Yeah.
You know, how to model good behavior when encountered with a negative influence. And so that might be the direction that, you know, you want to kind of push a TV show.
So are kids shows all about modeling behavior? Is it all about putting on screen how you hope children will learn to behave?
Well, it's certainly, I wouldn't make that sweeping generalization about every kid's show, but I would say that that's an important factor, is thinking about what message we're sending to our viewers, to our audience. In our case, it's not so much about modeling as it is about hoping to engage, mm-hmm. and hoping to inform and enlighten and excite and get, you know, interested in the arts and all that they have to offer.
What I really loved about your show, though, is that you have such a diverse puppet cast, you know, and what you were saying before about as a child being able to see yourself.
That's right.
In, you know, the situation, the experience, the arts, I think is really important for
young kids.
And that's
very,
kids.
Very intentional. I mean, we, you know, many, many communities have a local performing arts center or a community theater or something in their midst. And, you know, it can often seem intimidating to kids who haven't had that kind of exposure. And so we hope to say, this is a really inviting place, this is a friendly place, and to open up curiosity to want to go there.
In producing the show, do you have conversations, even in your head, about the balance between children's needs and the messages you want to send out and the needs of entertainment?
Absolutely. And
what is that like?
That's a really fine line to walk, you know, when we're writing the show and when we're producing the show, even something that the director has to keep in mind in terms of pacing and so forth. So we have to walk a very fine line between being, you know, obviously hitting all the marks from a curriculum point of view and from you know, an arts ed point of view, but also not doing it in such a way that is didactic.
Or
yeah, exactly.
Can you give me an example of one of those challenges and how you solved it?
Oh boy. Well, it's really, what it has to do with is, whenever possible, showing rather than telling, right? So not ever preaching to the kids, not ever setting them down and saying, you know, this is how you do such and such, and this is what you're supposed to do in this situation, but actually inviting them to engage with the situation and then saying, how did that make you feel? You know, what did you learn from that? Or what do you think you might do differently next time? You know, and each of our characters in the show encounters a personal sort of struggle in their character journey to figure out who they are in relationship to the rest of the group. And so we bump up against that a lot when a character has to suddenly discover that, oh, I can't always be the center of attention. I have to be part of a team, for instance, you know. But it's through the showing and the doing rather than nobody sits down and says to her, now you really need to learn how to
right.
do teamwork, you
Which,
know.
Which, I mean, it sounds like producing your show is a great lesson in parenting, too. I mean, my husband and I always say, we want our children to express gratitude to people in mm-hmm. their lives, but we make sure they see us say thank you to the server who hands us water
right.
when we're at a table mm-hmm. or the person who opens a door. You know, that's the best way, right? Instead of telling your kids, did you say thank you?
Right.
Which we end up doing
exactly,
as well.
Exactly, of course. It's a mix. It's a balance.
And there's research suggesting that way, they learn better that way. So they learn better when parents ask them questions
exactly.
instead of just telling them what to do.
Yeah.
So there's good support for the way that you're doing things on the show.
Phew. Thank you. Glad to know that.
I heard somebody say it once, and I won't say it as eloquently, but it was when you tell a child something, you're depriving them of the joy of discovery.
That's yes, exactly right.
That's right.
Exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
In episode 7, you had L.A. Kemper on to give an actual improvisational lesson, or lesson in improvisation. And she explains a very essential concept of yes and. As a producer, what were some of your thoughts behind that episode? And can you sort of explain the yes and?
Sure. So, well, yes and is sort of the fundamental tenet of successful improv. And what it means basically is if you're in an improvisation scene with a partner, and you say, it's raining, and your partner says, no, it isn't, it's sunny.
You just shut it down.
Yeah, like where do you go from there? You're kind of stuck, right? But if you say it's raining and your partner says, yes, and I forgot my umbrella.
Right, or we can hide under this elephant.
Exactly.
Whatever, yeah.
You know, it furthers the story. It keeps things moving forward. And
it's collaborative.
And it's collaborative.
It's respectful.
Exactly.
Of your fellow player.
Exactly. So that is the actual, from a writing and producing standpoint, that's the theme of that episode, is collaboration and teamwork. And so at the beginning of the show, the kids are, everybody wants to do their own thing, and they're sort of combative, and they're all in their own separate worlds. And Ellie comes in and teaches them through improv how to listen to one another and how to collaborate and build something creative as a result.
Isn't it the best life lesson for everyone? Yeah. I think if you could go into every company in America and give adults improv lessons,
exactly,
we'd all live in a happier place.
I totally agree.
Natalie, how might the theatrical improvisational idea of yes and kind of inform or affect a developing mind?
So from a cognitive perspective, this kind of exercise of yes and makes me think of asking a child an open-ended question, right? So it broadens their thinking processes, extends the conversation. They have to engage in a variety of skills. So they have to hold in mind what the topic of conversation is, and then they have to add some more information to it, you know, and that takes a lot of memory skills.
Yeah.
It also encourages them to use more vocabulary and language, which also all these potential pathways can really impact the developing brain. So it's a really great exercise in kind of getting them to further, you know, contribute to the conversation.
I also think it's an early, if children are lucky enough to learn about improv early, it's an early lesson in fearlessness and forgetting self-consciousness. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I remember as a child being in improv and you learning that you don't have to be funny. You just have to be part of the team.
Right.
Right.
Which is...
You just have to basically catch the ball, whatever
yeah.
it is, and mm-hmm. then add your own spin to it.
And right? and throw it to
and
somebody
throw it
else.
To somebody yeah. else. Yeah.
Emma, in the episode entitled The Show Must Go On, Julie's kids are putting on The Wizard of Oz. I think that's the first episode.
It is.
Yeah, that's my kids are so into it. Yeah. And something goes wrong. I think it's a pipe mm-hmm. that breaks down. Can you remind me how they solve that problem and
sure.
who helps them?
Well, yes, so they're all excited about putting on The Wizard of Oz as the reason they're there and what they're going to be learning how to do. And in the first episode, there's a burst pipe in the basement. And the basement is where they store all the props and costumes and scenery for all their shows. And so the ensuing flood from the pipe completely destroys the theater's stock. And, you know, it looks like they're not going to be able to do a show at all. And then they have to figure out, well, you know, can we still do a show? And if so, what might it be, since we don't have anything to do it with. But the good news is that the flood also brings with it Hugo the duck, who comes in through the burst pipe and is you know, a very useful duck in all possible ways, backstage and on stage. And then they get a visit from Idina Menzel, the wonderful singer and actress.
Oh, when I told my children, that's Elsa.
Right? I know, she's amazing. But she also, of course, starred in Wicked. And so she helps them, she teaches them how to brainstorm for ideas. She gets them a free trip to Wicked, and a tour backstage and for inspiration. And then when they come back, they brainstorm to figure out how they're going to solve this problem. And they discover that if they put together the few little things that they've managed to salvage from the flood, the props pieces and costume pieces, and then they mix up all the various different things they're interested in, the different types of music and dance and what have you, they could create a mashup. And so it'll be an original musical, and they'll call it Mashup the Musical. And every episode after that teaches them how to put the next building block in place to make that show.
As working as developmental psychologists, what do you all think about a show that talks about fixing and you know, working around the metaphor of a broken pipe?
I mean, I think that there are two really good things about this. One is that it teaches them flexibility. So, mm-hmm. I mean, young kids can be very, very rigid, and teaching them that, you know, even if their expectations aren't met, that there's some flexibility in outcomes, I think, is really important and encourages creativity. And the other is teaching them to solve problems on their own is really important. So, you know, as a developmental psychologist and also as a parent, you hear about all of this sort of helicopter parenting and parents doing things for their kids so that they don't have to solve problems on their own. And it's really important for kids to learn to solve problems on their own, because next time they're going to just have that toolkit with them to be able to be flexible and come up with multiple solutions to the same problem, instead of being stuck in one sort of script every time there's a problem, asking mom for help or expecting that somebody else is going to solve it for them. So I think there are multiple ways where encouraging problem solving and creativity is good for kids.
And yeah, it raises their self-esteem, right?
Yeah.
I mean, one of the lessons I had to learn as a parent was your best intentions are, oh, I want to help. Mm-hmm. I want to help.
Right.
But it's the standing back and letting them start to figure it out for themselves. Mm-hmm. That really teaches kids to be proud of themselves. I think what's really interesting about the show is that on the one hand, the little tasks that the kids have to face along the way to make this gigantic musical happen might seem mundane, but there's an emphasis on how all the components, you know, accumulate and work together. And Emma, was that intentional, presumably? I mean, or is that just how a show works? You can't get a show done unless everybody attends to his or her.
That is exactly how a show works. I mean, theater is an innately collaborative medium, and any one part missing affects the whole. And so that was very much a part of our intention to show that, you know, there's everybody is contributing something. And whatever your strength is, or whatever your area of interest is, or whatever your passion is, it's valid, it's important, and it's necessary for the whole thing to succeed. You know, if you take out any one part of it, it's all going to fall apart like a house of cards. But the teamwork and the collaborative effort and the building blocks of putting all of that together is what makes it happen.
And Vanessa and Natalie, what do you think? I mean, how important is it for little brains to grasp the idea that small solutions, no matter how small, can contribute to something meaningful?
Yeah, I think this building blocks idea is really important, because within our field, we have an idea called executive functions, which are, you know, cognitive skills that are around regulating or controlling your ability to think, to plan, you know, to act upon things. And these executive functions are not fully developed in young children. That's why when they're faced with a really difficult task, sometimes it's really overwhelming for them, right? They can't problem solve through. And so kind of breaking up a huge difficult task into small pieces helps them with their ability to problem solve, helps them to regulate their own emotions, so that when they are, you know, encounter another difficult task, they know that they can break it up into little chunks, and that they can, you know, with teamwork, solve the problem.
Natalie and Vanessa, what is the impact of arts education on developing brains?
So arts education has a huge impact on cognitive, social, and emotional development. You know, early on in life, neural connections are being formed at a really rapid rate. And these neural connections are being driven by experience. And as a kid, your experience is play, right? You want to engage in activities that engage in all the senses, you know, that help wire the brain for successful learning. And arts education does that, right? So you have tactile or touch cues, visual cues, auditory cues, even taste or olfaction or smell. And so areas of the brain are developing when kids are learning songs, when they're, you know, they're developing gross motor skills, when they're dancing, drawing pictures. And so I think it's really important that we do focus on arts education for brain development. And also, in addition, I feel like, you know, more rigid academic achievement or academic skills may not tap into the same types of thinking. So, you know, arts education promotes perspective taking and a lot of social emotional development that requires a lot of higher order cognitive skills that you may not see in reading or writing or math, I guess.
Do you want to add anything to that, Vanessa?
Well, just that it's especially important early in life when these connections are being made in, you know, in the preschool years and younger. The message is not to wait until kids are older when they're in high school to promote arts education, because the neural connections that Natalie's talking about are developing in the first few years of life. So it's a really important time to get them engaged in these sort of creative pursuits.
as all of us are parents or parents-to-be, and we hear so much of the emphasis on STEM today, mm-hmm. which stands for science, technology, engineering, and math, I think. And especially when it comes to girls, because mm-hmm. they've been underrepresented, you know, historically. But every time I hear that, you know, people started putting in an A. It's STEAM. Mm-hmm. I mean, look, I'm on a science show. I am infinitely interested mm-hmm. in science, but the arts and science overlap, bump up against each other in the most interesting ways. Mm-hmm. And this lack of prioritizing arts for our children, to me, is terrifying. That's the arts are what teach you what it means to be human.
Absolutely. You know? Well, they tell us who we are, you know. They hold up a mirror to our society, and they level the playing field, yeah. right? It doesn't matter what your socioeconomic background is. It doesn't matter where you come from or you know, what your experiences are. They are a neutral playing field where anyone can succeed if you just are willing to cultivate your imagination and express yourself creatively or appreciate what they have to offer.
Unfortunately, I think you're right that there is a meaningful socioeconomic impact involved in how young kids get to see theater.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So thank you for bringing it to as many homes as possible, and thank you for my own family. We have a new favorite show.
Thank you for watching.
Unfortunately, the curtain has to go down on this episode. It's all we have time for, but I'm so grateful all three of you joined us. For all of you watching, be sure to check out our Science Goes to the Movies Facebook page for web-only clips and keep up with everything related to Science Goes to the Movies all in one place. And if you want to watch past episodes or download our new podcast, check us out at cuny.tv.